Please be seated. The Spirit of the Lord fills the world, and He knows our every word and deed. So let us now open ourselves to the Lord. And let us confess our sins in penitence and in faith as we say together, Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing. Cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us. And restore to us the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And may the Father of all mercies cleanse us, cleanse you from all your sins, and restore you in his image, to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let everything be said and done in the name of the Lord Jesus.
Giving thanks to God through Jesus Christ.
Sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Open our lips, O Lord.
And we shall be so grateful.
And let us pray together that we may receive into our lives, into our community and fellowship, and into our hearts, the kingdom of God. O God of glory, the end of our searching, help us to lay aside all that prevents us from seeking your kingdom, and to give all that we have to gain this pearl beyond price, through our Saviour, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And now I invite you to sit and listen to a hymn. I think it will be a hymn that you haven't heard before. It's one you don't know. Certainly not one that we've sung here before, as far as I recall. But just listen to the words. Please remain seated.
My Redeemer, there is no more for heaven now. 1-8. So then, my friends, because of God's great mercy to us, I appeal to you. Offer yourselves as a living sacrifice to God, dedicated to his service and pleasing to him. This is the true worship that you should offer. Do not conform yourselves to the standards of this world, but let God transform you inwardly by a complete change of your mind. Then you will be able to know the will of God, what is good and is pleasing to him and is perfect. And because of God's gracious gift to me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you should. Instead, be modest in your thinking and judge yourself according to the amount of faith that God has given you. We have many parts in the one body, and all these parts have different functions. In the same way, though we are many, we are one body in union with Christ, and we are all joined to each other as different parts of one body. So we are to use our different gifts in accordance with the grace that God has given us. If our gift is to speak God's message, we should do it according to the faith that we have. If it is to serve, we should serve. If it is to teach, we should teach. If it is to encourage others, we should do so. Whoever shares with others should do it generously. Whoever has authority should work hard. Whoever shows kindness to others should do it cheerfully. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And then please remain seated for the next reading.
Gospel reading is taken from Matthew, chapter 16, beginning to read at verse 13. Jesus went to the territory near the town of Caesarea Philippi, where he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" "Some say John the Baptist," they answered. "Others say Elijah." "While others say Jeremiah, or some other prophets." "What about you?" he asked them. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." "Good for you, Simon, son of John," answered Jesus, "for this truth did not come from you, from any human being, but it was given to you directly by my Father in heaven. And so I tell you, Peter, you are a rock, and on this rock foundation I will build my church, and not even death will ever be able to overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. What you prohibit on earth will be prohibited in heaven, and what you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven." Then Jesus ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Come, Lord Jesus, in the fullness of your grace, and dwell in the hearts of us, your servants, that adoring you by faith, we may with joy receive you and evermore abide in you. Our guide, our bread of pilgrims, our comrade by the way. Amen. I can't get over the sight of so many of you here this morning. It's lovely to see you all to be able to share with you in this service. I want to begin with a product warning. And that is that I'm not infallible. Truly, I'm not. And the thing is, the reason when I sort of preach these sermons, or any preacher for that matter, we do it in order to stimulate the mind, to encourage discussion, to be able to move on from the point where we've given little dissertation, 2'6" above contradiction. And you can come after the service and say to me that you disagree. I suggest you don't come and say, Bill, that was a load of junk. But rather that you come and say, Bill, I was very interested in what you were saying today. Many of the things that you said actually struck a chord within me. But I look at it this way. So we have that understanding, do we? Okay, now the next thing that I wanted to do was to say to you, have you ever thought what kind of a person Paul was? You know, would you have welcomed him into you? Would you have felt comfortable with Paul in your home, having to share the lockdown with him for 3 months or whatever it was? What kind of a person is he? What kind of a person, you know, a picture of Paul do we have in our minds? He was somebody of tremendous determination. He was somebody with tremendous vision and insight. He was someone who was dedicated to the service of the Lord. But what kind of a person was he? What was he like to live with? And I think we have to stop, and people like me certainly have to stop, and we have to completely revise our picture of Paul. He wasn't a man driven to travel 100,000 miles or whatever it is across the Roman Empire or the Mediterranean in order to spread the gospel of Jesus. He wasn't driven. He wasn't narrow-minded. When people asked him, what's a Christian like? He said, well, a Christian is a person who is filled with love, joy, peace, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. Now, if Paul saw that in other people, and if Paul recognized that this was the work of the Holy Spirit, then that same Holy Spirit was at work with Paul. And Paul was a man who was filled with love, with joy, with peace, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. He'd been a lovely person to meet. He'd be a lovely person to share the day with. He might make us feel a bit uncomfortable. And he might give us insight into things that we'd never thought of before. But we would have felt good to be with him. We would have felt, you know, better for having met him for the day. So think about that and work out in your mind, what kind of a person is Paul? What kind of a rapport does he have with me? How does he affect and change my life when I come into contact with him? And then the second thing is, so what's Paul really concerned about? What really mattered to Paul? And it's very simple, really. What really mattered to Paul is that we should be one. That we should come together in fellowship, in love, in peace, in joy, and walk with each other in the power of the Spirit along the road of life. This was what Paul was desperately concerned about. This is what caused Paul to walk across the roads of Rome and sail in the ships of the sea and endure unimaginable trials. He wasn't a man driven to travel 100,000 miles or whatever it is across the Roman Empire or the Mediterranean in order to spread the gospel of Jesus. He wasn't driven. He wasn't narrow-minded. When people asked him, he said, well, a Christian is a person who is filled with love, joy, peace, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. Now, if Paul saw that in other people, and if Paul recognized that this was the work of the Holy Spirit,
then that same Holy Spirit was at work with Paul. And Paul was a man who was filled with love, with joy, with peace, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. He'd been a lovely person to meet. He'd be a lovely person to share the day with. He might make us feel a bit uncomfortable. And he might give us insight into things that we'd never thought of before. But we would have felt good to be with him. We would have felt, you know, better for having met him for the day. So think about that and work out in your mind, what kind of a person is Paul? What kind of a rapport does he have with me? How does he affect and change my life when I come into contact with him? And then the second thing is, so what's Paul really concerned about? What was really, what really mattered to Paul? And it's very simple, really. What really mattered to Paul is that we should be one. That we should come together in fellowship, in love, in peace, in joy, and walk with each other in the power of the Spirit along the road of life. This was what Paul was desperately concerned about. This is what caused Paul to walk across the roads of Rome and sail in the ships of the sea and endure unimaginable trials and hardships as he made his journey. And remember, incidentally, this is an aside that I haven't put in. He wasn't traveling alone. Paul wasn't a one-man band. He was working always as part of a team. But anyway, his main intention, the summary of all that he was saying, is that we shall be one in Christ, one body, with all the different arms and legs and heads and parts and lungs and all the rest of it, all working together in harmony for the glory of God and the development, the growth, the expansion of the kingdom. And that was all introduction, that the rest of the sermon is yet to come. So you take a deep breath, because there's a lot more to come yet, and will somebody tell me when I've exceeded my 10 minutes? You must tell me, by the way, otherwise there'll be problems on the internet, crash, or something horrible like that. Paul was in Corinth at this time, or somewhere near Corinth. The year was about 57 or so AD. About 30 years after Jesus, 35 years after Jesus had died. And he heard, somebody brought him news that there was a series of congregations, a series of fellowships in Rome that Paul had nothing to do with. He hadn't founded them. But these fellowships in Rome were having real troubles. They were split and they were divided. And this grieved Paul's heart. And he felt that he had something he could contribute, some understanding that he could share with them. What had happened was that the early evangelists or the families had moved into Rome with their, taking with them their Christian faith. And there they proceeded to live the life of Christ in Rome. They joined together with other Christians, but they discovered that some of their number were believers who once upon a time had been Jews. And they were hardline Jews. And they knew that Jesus was a Jew, Jesus was their Messiah, and they wanted to be obedient and to follow him. And therefore, people who were obedient and follow him, they had to become Jews too. And they had to adopt the law with all its commandments and insistences and so on. But then there were other folks who'd also had an experience of the presence of the Holy Spirit in their lives. And they found that it didn't mean that they had to become Jews. The Lord still works with them and through them and glorified his name, even though they weren't following the distinctive practices of the Jewish people, like circumcision or like eating special foods or whatever it might be. And they felt that they were right, and the Jews felt that they were right, and so they had a Barney. And they had a Barney in the congregations at Rome. And this did nothing for the truth of the peace of God, which passes all understanding. It had nothing to say about Christ unifying all in himself. And Paul was distressed, and so he wrote his letter. He says, think of yourselves as a body. And if the left arm is at odds with the right arm, and the left leg is at odds with the right leg, then you're in trouble. Everything must work together in harmony. We are the body of Christ. And we are to work together in spite of all our difficulties, we're not all the same. We all have different gifts and talents. A tongue is meant to do one job, a hand is meant to do another job, a foot is meant to do another job, a stomach is meant to do another job, hearts are meant to do other jobs, lungs are meant to do other. We all have different jobs, different contributions to make, but we all belong to the same body. And this has its implications for us in Hale, in Hale Bank, in West Bank. We are the body of Christ. And we're here to make Christ's purpose known in the local community. But we're to do so using the different gifts and talents that we all have among ourselves. And to use these different talents and these different understandings to approach other people in love, in hope, in faith, in confidence, in assurance, and to enable the knowledge of the presence of God to grow among us. I think that's all I want to say. But remember, I'm not above contradiction. And what I'm saying is meant to say, how does this sound to you? Can we work together, Holy Spirit, to build up his community, his fellowship, his people, his body, here in Hale and Hale Bank, and also in West Bank? The next thing that we say together is we believe. And if the screen says that, that's what we do. And if it does say that, spring to your feet, and we'll be able to get on to the next part of the service. So let us declare our faith in Almighty God, and let us say together, we believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Now we're going to join together in our prayers of intercession. So please be seated and let us pray together.
The response of the following prayers is, yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory. Your will be done, O Lord. Yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory. Your will be done, O Lord. We pray for people who struggle with their faith through self-doubt, through difficult circumstances, through bad things happening, through being led astray by wanting fame and fortune. We trust you, Lord, to answer our prayers. Yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory. Your will be done, O Lord. We pray for people who feel in the dark, locked in a situation where they can find no answer, that they might come to understand that you are the key to everything they need. We trust you, Lord, to answer our prayers. Yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory. Your will be done, O Lord. We pray for ourselves when we are in difficult situations, when we try to unlock those that aren't ours to unlock, when we don't focus on the kingdom, when we don't share our story. We trust you, Lord, to answer our prayers. Yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory. Your will be done, O Lord.
Let us say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge of the love of God and of his Son, Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon us and remain with us always. Amen. So go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. Again, go in peace, and you do it to one another, not just to me. Thank you all very much indeed. Go and have a great week, and it's been lovely to share this service with you here this morning.
Traveling the way I should, where I see no place to go. You'll be there.
just before we go, Roland, are there any notices which need to be given out?
It's just to reiterate again, our annual meeting on the 13th of September, and the idea about that was we'll have our service at 11 o'clock, a bit of a cup of coffee, and then continue our meeting. I'm hoping that we'll have a Zoom facility set up as well, because of course, not everybody who wants to be here, because I know everybody wants to be able to come and meet and don't you? But we can have a Zoom facility as well, so that people can... it won't be a long meeting. I always say that, it always is, don't I? But a very important meeting, and at that time we'll be electing our wardens, members to the church council, members to Deanery Synod. But it's a great time to celebrate where we are as a church, what's happened over the last year, but also thinking about the future as well. Such an important meeting. Deacon, I think today is the last day for electoral roll, isn't it, Jeff?
It is, yeah.
So if anybody's still not sure about whether they want the electoral roll or not, or whether they should be, please speak with Jeff before you go home. And nomination forms are in the porch as you leave. If you want to know any more about that, please do speak